Ciao everyone, this is Nate on the Stone, welcome back to my channel, and today we are going to be talking about why the world's oldest profession needs to remain illegal. I am, of course, referring to prostitution, and you are right, there is an actual movement to decriminalize it, and interestingly enough, this idea has support from both the left and the right. On the left, one of the ideas seems to be that if prostitution, or sex work, is decriminalized, then sex workers, or prostitutes, will be actually safer when they ply their trade, we'll say, because they'll be able to file reports of abuse or leave the business that they want without fear of getting arrested by the police or retaliation from their pimps. But there's also an ideological component in there as well, with some activists saying that prostitution is actually completely in line with feminism. Now, you might be scratching your head at that one, wondering, I thought that feminism was all about empowering women, so how does trading your body for money line up with that? Well, according to some activists, like Annie Sonny, the idea that a woman can be independent and support herself with just her body is incredibly empowering, and so, yeah, prostitution fits right in with feminism. And while on the right, mostly libertarians, there is that idea of safety too, there are also two additional ideas. One, that whatever consenting adults decide to do in the privacy of their bedroom, hotel room, water room, wherever, is absolutely nobody's business but their own. And two, if we're really serious about defending and expanding human freedom, then that logically requires us to want to decriminalize prostitution. The idea here is that freedom expands the less laws there are, because laws are constrictive. So, get rid of the laws against prostitution means that there will be more choice and more human movement for freedom. Now, this push to decriminalize prostitution has actually been around for a while, with both Human Rights Watch and Amnesty International drafting proposals calling for the sex trade to be decriminalized. But it received a jolt of energy at the end of February this year when Democratic presidential candidate hopeful Senator Kamala Harris said in an interview with The Root that prostitution should be decriminalized. In the interview, she said, quote, "But when you are talking about consenting adults, I think that, you know, yes, we should really consider that we can't criminalize consensual behavior as long as no one is being harmed," unquote. Now, before going on, let me make just a few things absolutely crystal clear, gang. 1. No woman should be exploited. 2. Consent is very important. 3. Human freedom should absolutely be fought for and expanded where it can be. But none of those three things actually justify legalizing or decriminalizing prostitution. Let's look at the practical angle first, the idea that decriminalizing prostitution will lead to a decrease in human exploitation and human trafficking. On the surface, this sounds like a logical idea. If prostitution is illegal, that means that it's going to go underground. And if it goes underground, that means the chances of women, prostitution's commodity, being exploited, trafficked, and abused are much higher. But bring it all out into the light, make it a business, no different from any other, have it pay taxes, and all those problems will be significantly decreased. The problem, though, is that this isn't how it works. April of 2018, for the UK Guardian, Julia Bindle wrote a piece called "Prostitution is Not a Job, The Inside of a Woman is Not a Workplace," in which she talked about the after effects of New Zealand decriminalizing prostitution in 2003. The government of New Zealand promised, crossed their hearts, that decriminalization would help bring about less violence, regular inspection of brothels, and a decrease in sex trafficking. Promises which never came about. According to Bindle, quote, "Trafficking of women into New Zealand into legal and illegal brothels is a serious problem, and for every licensed brothel, there are on average 4 times the number that operate illegally. Violent attacks on women in the brothels are as common as ever. Under legalization, women are still murdered by pimps and punters," unquote. But decriminalization didn't just not fix the old problems. It actually made the problem worse. Since prostitution was decriminalized in 2003, the government of New Zealand has basically washed its hands of sex workers and has stopped funding government services that were created specifically to help women get out of prostitution because, let's face it, if prostitution is just another business under the law, no different from working at a McDonald's or working at a bank or a department store, then women who want to leave prostitution don't need the government's help to do so, which means that women are still being exploited, trafficked, abused, and killed, and there are no government services for them to turn to actually help them get out of this business. But maybe it doesn't matter if the practical problems aren't solved by decriminalizing prostitution. If consent is all that's needed to make an action morally good or at least neutral, and if freedom actually is expanded by decriminalizing prostitution, maybe we should be open-minded and think about that idea seriously. I mean, if the practical problems are going to exist, whether prostitution is illegal or not illegal, then maybe we should err on the side of choice and freedom. But these two more philosophical defenses of decriminalization don't work either. Let's take consent first. Consent is almost becoming a magic word in society today. We think that if adults consent to something, then it can't be 100% wrong. We might disagree with it. We might think that it's wrong for us, but hey, they're adults, they gave their consent, nothing that we can say or do, right? The problem with that thinking is that if consent is made the only measurement of if an action is right or wrong, then we could very easily find ourselves living in a society where something like cannibalism is morally and socially acceptable. Now, you might laugh at that. You might think, oh, come on, Nate, that's never gonna happen. Except that it already has. No joke. Back in 2003 in Germany, Armin Mavis was arrested for quote-unquote murder for the purpose of sexual pleasure, as well as quote-unquote disturbing the peace of the dead. Translation? He had killed another man named Bernd Brandes and then proceeded to eat him over the course of the next couple of weeks. Now, murder, pure and simple, right? Slam dunk conviction. The jury only convicted Mavis of manslaughter. And the reason for that was because Brandes actually agreed to be killed and eaten. No joke. Brandes actually answered an online advertisement that Mavis sent out where he said quite clearly that he was looking for a well-built young man to have sex with and then kill and eat. And Brandes agreed and accepted all those conditions. Now, I'm not saying that if consent is made the only measurement of right or wrong, that we're going to find ourselves living in a society of Hannibal Lecters. But if someone decides to try the Lecter lifestyle and gets all of his victims to sign the dotted line, then how are we actually going to condemn him? This actually leads to another problem with consent being the only measurement of if something is right or wrong, and that is that it destroys the principle of non-contradiction, which is just another big fancy philosophical way of saying that something can't be and not be at the same time. This tree, for instance, it can't be a tree and a toothpick at the same time. Lying to your parents can't be good and bad, right and wrong at the same time. But consent as the only measurement of right and wrong destroys this principle. Let's say that Fred and Ned decide that cannibalism is okay and they consent to it. Cannibalism now is okay for them. But at the exact same time, and just the next house over, Jim and Tim decide that cannibalism is not for them and they don't consent to it. So cannibalism is wrong for them. Cannibalism is right and wrong at the same time. And what this does is open a whole host of questions. For example, can a legal system actually exist where the legality of actions depends on the changing whims of individuals? Can a society actually even exist when we decide that we're going to interact with reality in that way? But what about freedom? Wouldn't decriminalizing prostitution give more people more choices and so expand their freedom? Maybe, but only if freedom means getting rid of constraints, and it can't mean that because, ironically, if it did, we would actually destroy our freedom every time we made a choice. Because making choices actually constricts us, because every time we make a choice, we're actually closing off options for ourselves. If I decide to be healthy, that means that I can't eat as many fish fillet sandwiches as I would like. If I decide that I need to grow my savings account by X amount of dollars by such and such a date, it means that I might not be able to travel the world like I had planned, or it might mean that I can't eat a fish fillet sandwich every night for supper. Freedom can't just be about getting rid of constraints, although that is part of it. Freedom also has to be for something. Now, what does freedom have to be for? I would argue that it has to be for what we might call the good. What is moral, what is right, what is true. But can't prostitution be part of that category of the good? No. In the first place, prostitution makes us think of other people as only objects, there to give us sexual relief. And the problem with that is that people aren't objects. That's one of the whole reasons why slavery is wrong, because it takes a person and says to him, you're an object, no different than my iPhone, or my car, or a mannequin. I know that some women willingly choose to go into prostitution, and they say that it's empowering, but the thing is, even if you choose it, the whole thing about sex work is that in it, a woman is seen only as an object, a body designed to give sexual pleasure to another body. And since we're not just bodies, and we're not just objects for somebody else's use, anytime someone uses another person just as an object for their own ends, that is always wrong. Period. Full stop. No ifs, ands, or buts. Second, decriminalizing prostitution will make more people lose their self-control. We already have a problem with this issue. Just look at the obesity and the pornography epidemic. And that's a problem because freedom to do what is good requires self-discipline. It requires us to conquer ourselves. But legalizing prostitution says, you don't need self-control. Buying sex is no different than buying a Big Mac. And since Big Macs are tasty and sex is pleasurable, why not buy as many of both as you can? Ironically, decriminalizing prostitution will not give people the freedom to say no. It will actually enslave more people to be unable to say anything except yes. But what say you? Will decriminalization ironically constrict human freedom? Or in the 21st century, is it a necessary step to actually expand our freedom of choice? And what are your thoughts about what freedom is anyway? As always, I would love to hear your thoughts, your opinions, your comments down in the comments section below. Well, that about wraps up everything for right now, gang. As always, if you liked the video, whether you agreed with me or not, then don't forget to give the video a like, leave a comment, share it with your friends on Twitter, Facebook, the other social platforms. Anything you do helps me and the channel, guys, and I am very grateful to you all. And if you like videos about the culture, politics, or religion, but from a different POV, then don't forget to subscribe to the channel and to ring that bell for notifications so that you will always know when I post new videos like this every Tuesday. Videos that you're not going to want to miss. Thank you as always for watching, for giving me a little bit of your day. Thank you to everyone who has subscribed to my channel. I am grateful to you all. And I will see you all again here, gang, next week on Top of the Stone. Ciao.